Just
okay.
Baba sang the chorus and I taped it, and all I had to do was go to a slightly different couple of chords and write why were the reasons that I, and then of course so many people sing it now, why he can't get through. We're blocked. We block ourselves. We do this. And then he says, I'm waiting until you're ready. I'm a breath away until the beat is steady. The highest union our souls to mix. These words just came as I played the chorus back. Like the whole thing happened in less than 24 hours because Baba wrote the chorus. I didn't have anything to do, you know.
That's so beautiful. I don't get psychic messages like that.
Oh, I'm the most unpsychic, Taurus rising person you ever met in your life. But I have dreamt two of the most gorgeous songs. So I figured nothing to do with me whatsoever.
That's like Julia Ward Howe when she got the transmission about the battle hymn of the Republic. She dreamed all the words. God
did. Really? Wow.
Yeah, and you could think of the chorus, they are British English, you know, and I'm not British. And so...
But you are Aussie.
I'm an Aussie, yeah.
That counts.
But I'm from Melbourne, you see, and we're so much more sophisticated than the rest of Australia because we have elocution in school and the rest of Australia doesn't.
Curtsy. Thanks.
Yeah. So I've got a Taurus rising too. Is that why I don't dream of Baba?
Well, it just makes it practical. And so sometimes we just think that's a bit fuzzy. But Baba helps us go there. But I have two songs and they're both in the same open sea dreamy mode. And it taught me about the open sea dreamy mode. I didn't know such a chord existed. So. And my first song I ever sang to Mara in 1977 was the other dream of her and Baba. That was complete, though, that one.
Wow.
There's a few people who are joining late. Would you like to sing the song again now that you've introduced it so well?
It's a beautiful song, Rainey. So you wrote it, yeah?
Yes.
You're just knowing it.
What's his name, Jeff, from New York, that sings everybody's songs? That's such a good musician and guitarist.
Bill Cliff.
Bill Cliff sings it, a beautiful version. Yeah. And now I've noticed Jim Meyer sings it. And I suppose a lot of people sing it. I don't know if they know I wrote it. So, I didn't write it. I don't know if that, they probably sense Baba wrote it, right? Okay. Are you all right with this, Jeff?
Yes, fine.
And that's that chord. It's just C and like that. It's open. I think you could write 200 songs to this chord.
Very mystical.
It is lyrical, isn't it?
Lyrical, yes.
Uh-huh. I should point out, though, that BJ is on the second bunk. No, now he's back.
Did I frighten him away, BJ? Did I frighten you? I'm sorry. BJ has a habit of sleeping on our living room floor for weeks on end. You know, he thinks he lives here too.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Always welcome.
Thank you, Rainey. Yeah, Jay Wab.
Come with me. Let me melt you on the sunny warm shore. Come with me. Yes, let me melt you. Show you lovers what your lovely heart is for. I can't get through your coat of armor. I wish I could your love to savor. But darling, it's so hard a battle you've built so well. Your outer shell. But come with me. Let me melt you on the sunny warm shore. Come with me, let me melt you. Show you lovers what your lovely hearts are for. I feel resistance, a flow that's blocked. Give me the key to your heart, it's locked. I must give in till you surrender. Wait for that special love so tender. So come with me. let me melt you on the sunny warm shore. Come with me, yes, let me melt you. Show you lovers what your lovely hearts are for. I'm here waiting until you're ready. A breath away till the beat is steady. The highest union our souls to mix. Only the purest of hearts I pick. Come with me, let me melt you on the sunny warm shore. Come with me, yes, let me melt you and show you lovers what your lovely hearts are for. Shining hearts melting into me. Let me melt you on the sunny warm shore. Come with me, yes, let me melt you. Show you what your lovely hearts are for.
Beautiful.
Jay Baba, beautiful. Absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, beautiful, Rainey. She's got a lot of lovely songs and great voice.
And she wrote this one.
Now, let's see. Alan was going to come in. I'll read a few quotes here. If you look at VJ, he's on the second bunk in a room, in his room there, peering over. Okay. This is St. Teresa of Avila. A thousand souls hear his call every second. But most look into their life's mirror and say, I'm not worthy to leave this sad place. When I first heard his courting song, I too looked at all I had done in my life and said, how can I gaze into his omnipresent eyes? But he told me, I made you dear, and all I make is perfect. Please come close, for I too desire you. That was Kitty really liked that line, please come close, for I too desire you. Because she found that Baba was actually more eager to merge with them than they were to merge with him. And she found that almost unbelievable. Here's a famous Christian saying, and it kind of links up with Baba. The Christian mystics found Jesus within them. The early Christians found Jesus beside them. And that's really kind of what Baba said, that for the next 100 or 200 years, it would be like he was still physically with us. But then afterwards, we'd have to dive deep within to find him. Oh, here's Rumi. Looking within is excruciatingly painful, but it will tear open the veils. The beloved will be seen. Until Mary goes into labor, how can Jesus be born? Looking within is excruciatingly painful, but it will tear open the veils, and the beloved will be seen. Until Mary goes into labor, how can Jesus be born? That's Rumi. Here's a good one, a famous one, Saint Augustine. Give me chastity and continence, but not just yet. Okay, this is the last one, folks. This is Rumi. I do not speak these words of love. Love speaks them. This subject is something I know nothing about. You can tell the story of love if you are 1,000 years old. When can I know? I am a child of the present. Yet the child I am is a parasite on the eternal one. And my union with him makes me ancient. I'll read that one. That's, I do not speak these words of love. Love speaks them. This subject is something I know nothing about. You can tell the story of love if you are 1,000 years old. What can I know? I am a child of the present. Yet the child I am is a parasite on the eternal one, and my union with him makes me ancient. Ho, ho, ho. Let's see.
Who is that last one, Jeff?
That's Rumi.
Oh, Rumi.
Jalaluddin Rumi. Yeah.
Wow.
So, Alan is going to come on at some point. Oh, Anita is here from Vancouver Island.
Hi.
Yeah. Oh, good. Now, do they sometimes call you Anita?
Yeah, in Farsi, they say Anita. Yeah.
Anita. She's the daughter of this whole family that grew up around the Prem Ashram boys in Iran.
And where do you live, Anita, on the island?
I'm in Nanaimo.
Oh, you're in Nanaimo. I lived at Qualicum for a few years.
Oh, cool. Very close by.
Hey, Jeff, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Came from our Zoom of 10 minutes ago. They talked about 5 universal centers in America.
No.
5 universal centers. Yeah.
Or 5 universal centers in the world?
No, America. In America.
America.
In America. Yeah.
So it's America, it's the center.
Myrtle Beach.
Right, in Myrtle Beach. Is it their Marymount?
Baba said there would be 5 mental centers.
Oh, so how many do we have?
So
I think
far,
we have 4. I think we have 4.
I can't think of 4 if you're not counting Marymount.
Oh,
Marana.
Right.
LA is a big, they say one in a big city, one in the center, which is Prague. This is me. I don't know. And
Baba didn't specify what the 5 were.
No,
so
we
can't
are.
Just start naming them and saying that those are they. He just
he said that one would be in the mountains and one would be in the, I believe, in the center.
Desert.
So what's in the mountain? Which one is in the mountain? Oh, Marana. Marana.
Let's say that, yeah.
In the desert, not in the
But you can't.
You can't.
No, we're all guessing.
You can't say it that way because, hey, Asheville's in the mountains. I mean, like, you know.
And Mayher Mount's in the mountains, too.
Yeah. But it's not really a center because it didn't.
Well, Oklahoma's not a center yet either. It's tiny, but it's going to grow. So we don't know how it's going to grow.
It is a center in the sense that there's a physical space there.
Well, and it's got great significance, Oklahoma.
And Baba visited Mayher Mount.
Yeah, Baba was at Mayor.
That's true.
Yeah. We're just having a grand time
peace,
of speculating.
Peace, sister. Peace.
The one we don't have is a desert. Where?
A desert, right. We don't have a desert.
No.
Jeff, you can start.
California's a desert, people. California is a desert.
I'm going to Death
Valley.
I'm
going to
be. I'm opening up a center in Death Valley.
Fereshte went to a center in the desert. She went to the Eshkat's Baba Samadhi in
one time, person at a time.
Earl Starcher built the replica of the Samadhi. That's right, in New Mexico.
Sort of
desert,
that's right. Isn't that desert, that place?
Well, yeah, it is. Yeah. But, and also one in a big city, I think he said.
Well, LA is a desert.
LA is a big city, yeah.
And it's a desert.
Well.
Let's have one poem from Michael Childs, and the speculation can keep going on. And actually, VJ is the one who knows.
Good.
Michael needs to read us the fifth guzzle. A, B, C, D. Guzzle E, please, Michael. This will solve the whole problem. The fifth guzzle will tell us.
Okay. Think of this. This is a message from Baba.
It's the oracle.
Yeah. Uh-oh, we can't hear you, Michael.
I hope it doesn't have a, you know what, penis in it. Like other poems did. Can't hear you.
You're muted, Michael.
Only half of us can read lips.
How's that? Is that better?
There, you got it. Okay.
So, Betty, where would we be without penises? You know?
Well, yeah.
Go ahead, Michael.
Well, hey, that's how it works. Well, and Guzzle E happens to deal with sex, so I'm going to pick another one.
Okay.
Oh, Michael.
Yeah. Keep it clean, Michael.
Guzzle M, what is the purpose of life? What is the meaning of it all? Why do people kill each other? Why do children play? What did you do today and yesterday? And did you know that white whales beach themselves and die? That particles of dust make you sneeze? Why and why and where and why and what and why and how? This is the quid pro quo that forms the quilt work of our lives, the conversations that fill the mind, the questions that kill the heart, the empty, mindless, time-consuming words and deeds that inches closer to the bleak and frightening end that is the final answer to the question, why? Friend, you are not to be found in these perturbations of the mind. You are found between the cracks of thought when the mind is stilled by paradox. Lover of mine, you hold my chin with your thumb and forefinger. Looking deep into my eyes, I see your boundless love. Bedazzled, I forget to even ask you when.
Good. Hey, let's see. Now that Josh has recovered from his illness, any thoughts or anything that springs to mind?
Yes, I came prepared. I have this. I don't know where I got this. It's a book called Mayor Barber Calling. It's very small and it's, I think, mostly Barbara's birthday messages, but some really good stuff. It's actually really good. And this is something called Be Resigned to My Will. Be content with your lot, whether rich or poor, happy or miserable. Understand that God has designed it for your own good and be resigned to his will. Be resigned completely to my will and my will be yours. Some like work, some like play, but when you do it for me, then it is the same. This is Vedanta in a nutshell. I want you to remain undisturbed and unshaken by the forces of life's currents. For whatever the circumstances, they too will be of my own creation. If you endure your lot with patience and contentment, accepting it as his will, you are loving God.
That's a tall order. I mean, to accept everything, good, bad, and ugly, as my beloved's will. That is not, has not been easy for me. It's gotten much, much better though, as you get older.
I use it when I don't do my homework, you know, because it says here, some like work, some like play. And I'm like, that's me, I don't like working. But then I think, oh, I'll play for Barbara and I'll not do my homework for Barbara. And then that way, that's how I allow myself to not do my homework.
Yeah. Darwin used to call that a metaphysical rationalization. No, that's good. No, it's hard. Hard to keep at. I'm glad that I'm done with college. Sorry, you know, I feel, we all feel for you, Josh.
oh no, you guys are going to get right back into it. You know, it's just going to be the blink of an eye and then you'll be reincarnated again and you'll be ready to go.
I'm not going to learn the times tables one more time. I'm finished with that. No. Hey, so let's see, Mayor Prasad, you got a quote there and let's see if, or Anita, anything that comes to mind with you there?
Been listening to the recordings. I think one of the more recent ones, or maybe it was last week's Effort and Grace, you brought up the current, you know, the invisible current.
Yeah.
That, and actually Angela sent me, I asked her to email me the Google Doc thing that you had put together. And today I was actually trying to like use that to face like whenever, because I feel like one of my core emotions one of the core ones is fear and anxiety. And so and you've mentioned this before, like feeling it in the present. And then I was thinking, okay, well, I'm not the one who has to get rid of this, and just like imagining that current and it's flowing everywhere. It's like, I'm not in charge of it. It's just flowing and it's what's going to kind of dissolve this fear, this anxiety, and just kind of tapping into that instead of like struggling with the fear and the feeling that you feel, like the fluttering and all of that, and just using the current that's already there, even if it comes to a stop. It's like just knowing, like being reassured that it is always there and it never actually goes away, and Baba's always there and he never goes away, and that reassurance just kind of helps dissolve things quicker, or gets them to pass. Like you can kind of get the love to flow through the feelings so that you're not having to get rid of them. Because I find sometimes when I try to give something to Baba, my ego like expects it to be gone right away, and it's like, I want this to be gone, why do I still feel this way? But if I can just kind of leave it in the current, and the current can take it, and he's in charge of the current, and however Baba wants to deal with it, it's his job, then it's like it takes that responsibility off of me. Like I'm not responsible for getting rid of this feeling of anxiety.
Beautiful. Yeah. I mean, we all have these deep core emotions that we rarely even have a chance to get to the root of, except as you often, very often, outer circumstances that bring it up. And then we do have to work on it. But yeah, Darwin, just to kind of reiterate what you read, is Darwin used to say there's an invisible current in each of us. And he used to kind of gesture it this way. The current of most people is going toward I, my, me, and mine. That current has to be reversed, flow into Baba, and then flow out to the world, you know, but flow, you know, he used the word, we're meant to be fluidic. I mean, I had never heard that word used up to that moment. I mean, in that, as a current, but to flow. And if we can flow through things, and it doesn't, and even if it gets stopped, but continue to try to flow through things, then one part of us is not getting narrowed down, you know.
Yeah, and then I feel like you're not attached, like when it's flowing and when you're fluidic, you're not able to attach to any of it. You remain kind of detached and things just keep going and you're free, like that feeling of being free and just with Baba and nothing else. The tentacles are withdrawn and you're just, yeah,
that's
like the best feeling ever.
Yeah. Yeah, that's been my practice since the early 70s, you know, the flow. I mean, I start early in the morning working with the flow and putting Baba's name on it. And it makes life much more expansive. And rather than shrinking down, consciousness will shrink down to the size of the problem we've got. Even Einstein said, no problem can be solved with the same consciousness that went into creating it. We have to go to a wider consciousness to, but yeah, good. I kind of wrote that up sitting on this sofa right beside me here in the gateway.
Awesome, thank you.
With a lot of these extra hours of, you know, during the pandemic. Any, but beautiful, Anita, that I find it's just so touching that everybody's working on these just to free themselves up proactively. It's something beautiful.
Well, I just, like, I had an episode like a year, basically just before the pandemic, where it was kind of like my breaking point where anxiety was at such a height and I like basically had to surrender. I was going crazy. And I think since that moment, it was, and I think everyone kind of has these moments where there's some sort of crisis that gets them to really connect with Baba. Because I, up until then, like, I knew Baba and I did things with him, but I didn't feel like I did. I don't know. It wasn't that same personal relationship, like the fun, loving, like, I want you. I want to be with you more and more. I want to love you more and more. And putting the effort in, it kind of like comes more. It's the effortless effort, I guess, that until you get to that crisis point, sometimes you don't put in the effort.
Yeah. Yeah, you wonder. I mean, all these kind of obstacles and everything, they well, that is, there's expression, you know, it's the sand in the oyster shell that produces the pearl, the irritation in our psyche that produces these. Yeah, let's see. Jake, let me see what Jake is. Jake has always got some very thoughtful things. If we can get him out of the shadows here.
Hey, Jeff, I'm here. I'm walking my dog, so there's not much to see at this point, but I just wanted to come on and say hello, and then just add that, you know, for me, one of the biggest flowing or fluidic inspirations is Baba's, you know, accident anniversary coming up tomorrow, and just how, for me, it's been so helpful this anniversary coming up to kind of really force me to look at and shake up my obsessions that kind of crowd out Baba, specifically because for me, I was really feeling how much Baba's suffering and the accident and shedding blood on American soil is so much for, you know, helping people break the obsessions and bring internal focus, bring about an internal focus on him, on love, on the divine within. And so I just was reflecting on that just a couple of minutes ago with a friend, actually, in listening to you guys. I was texting a friend talking about that, how impactful it's been for me, feeling the importance of Baba's call in relationship to the accident anniversary, you know, because if I didn't, I feel like if I didn't let that obsession change or shift or be fluid with it, that, you know, I'd be spitting in the face of Baba's suffering, per se, you know, trying to work against the very thing that he has come here for, which is my freedom and liberation. So that's one thing I have.
Yeah, let me ask you, what was I going to say here? I have blanked out. I had a question to ask you, but maybe it'll come to me.
Yeah, no, that's all right. You know, it was, I do have one more thing here. Let me see if I can find it here. There was I was reading recently something from a book about Carl Jung. It was his, it's a biography of his. And you know, for those who are familiar, Carl Jung, you know, did some immense internal work, internal investigation. And let's see if I can find it here. Okay, yeah, here it is. All right. So these are Carl Jung's words, who's, you know, again, did some amazing self-exploration, you know, deepening in his relationship to the divine, whether that's what he called it or not. But this passage here so beautifully sums up for me, you know, Baba's coming, and one of the most important, an important aspect of Baba's coming. And it says, an autobiography is so difficult to write because we possess no standards, no objective foundation from which to judge ourselves. There are really no proper basis for comparison. I know this in many things. I am not like others, but I do not know what I really am like. Man cannot compare himself with any other creature. He is no monkey, not a cow, not a tree. I am a man, but what is it to he that? Like every other being, I am a splinter of the infinite deity, but I cannot contrast myself with any animal, any plant or stone. Only a mythical being has a range greater than man. How then can a man form any definite opinion about himself? And this, to me, I mean, you know, this is deeply insightful on Carl Jung's part. And this, to me, so perfectly gives rise to the importance of Baba's coming as God in human form to give man a form that is definite, to form an opinion about himself, to form the opinion of himself, of ourselves, that we are God, that God and we are one. And I just, I feel so blown away by that. The importance of Baba coming in human form, the importance of Baba suffering to help bring us to the place of knowing ourselves as he.
Yeah, you know, Baba sent Norena to Carl Jung.
Oh, really?
To invite him to come and see him. But for some reason, he wasn't able to. But he did have that, you know, that contact was made.
Yeah.
Wow. I was going to share a story that Baba told, but I might save that for a little bit. let me see. Mayor Prasad, you have anything there? Anything that came up in the intervening week?
You asked for a quote. I have one I can read. Good. I think this is probably from Discourses. I don't have the source. Cravings have a tendency to pervert the functioning of critical reasoning. And an unwavering faith, which is grounded in pure intuition, can come only to a mind which is free from the pressure of diverse wants. True faith is therefore a matter of gradual growth. It grows in proportion to the success which the disciple attains in freeing his consciousness from diverse cravings.
Yeah, beautiful. I think I've mentioned before that there's one of the saints of India named Sri Aurobindo who said that faith is an intuition yet to be proven by experience. Faith is kind of a, you might say, a veiled intuition that still needs to be proven by experience. But I know I remember Baba chastising Kitty, and I think it was Margaret, by that Bob was talking about faith, and Kitty said, well, we don't bother about faith. You know, basically, we know you are who you are. And Baba kind of chided them for their, from what I understood, kind of their insensitivity to other people who are still developing faith. And it hasn't turned into knowing yet.
Jeff, do you think that faith is a gift, or is it something that a person could practice to have?
Both. I mean, I think faith is a gift, but also it helps to cultivate it. The more you cultivate it, the more the intuition that's hidden in the faith can expand, and that intuition will eventually become a conviction. You know, Sri Aurobindo gave this figure of the difference between intuition and illumination. And he gave the figure of someone traveling on a moonless night, and they're moving across the country, basically blind, but then there's a flash of lightning, which illumines their journey for a little bit. And so they're able to move kind of with some surety, and then they're in darkness and they're kind of groping around, another flash of light, and they can see the next stretch ahead of them. Anyway, when those flashes of lightning become continuous enough that you can begin to see the land that you're moving across, mm-hmm. then intuition is starting to turn into illumination. So you can see it's gradual. But once you get more and more flashes, then you can start to see the countryside that you're traveling across. Yeah. Okay. Hey, Vijay. Yeah.
Yeah, Jai Baba. Yeah, that's wonderful, Jeff. Maharshi Aurobindo was whom Baba gave God realization also. He was a politician earlier, then turned the spiritual aspirant. And so regarding faith, Baba told my father, it is given in the Lord Mahar, Sulu and Sudama, that he appreciated Sulu's faith, though he has not seen my real form, but I appreciate his faith and trust in me. And he folded his both hand and he did appreciate it. Yeah.
Beautiful. That's Vijay's father. Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you think if you've got a lot of faith that you can tolerate days and days of Zoom and not get like a little wacko?
I know. Today, this weekend has been unbelievable. I was thinking maybe I could convince all of you that to end this in about a half hour. I've had a little bit of zooming, but you know,
I have a question, and maybe you answered it and I just spaced out.
Wait 1 second, I want to tell Jake, there's a fantastic movie that we all just saw about the Heartland Center.
Oh, that's beautiful.
And did you see it?
I got to catch a couple minutes of it before we had to put the kids down for bed. It looked really, really
okay,
good.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Make sure, if you can get a chance to see it. I think Marta's...
Make sure you bring a whole lot of tissues.
What's that? Yeah.
Make sure you bring a whole lot of tissues.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Do you... I sobbed through the whole thing. Pathetic. I'm still sobbing if I think about it.
Oh, good. I think that's a beautiful thing, actually. I'm glad that you saw
it. It's a barber wash. It's the best...
Wasn't it incredible?
Yeah.
I think it was just incredible. I mean,
And wow. Then Martha,
something that was recorded.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Martha said, there's 6 minutes of Mara talking about the accident.
Mm-hmm.
Our night.
Martha, yeah. Did we see
that's
that?
Tomorrow. That's tomorrow.
Okay. Yeah.
That'll be tomorrow night at 7:30. Yeah.
There's a special 12-step program for Zoom confusion.
Sign me up. Jeff, I really feel sorry for you. I had to host Arti 2 days running, talk about dive in to the deep end first off. Oh my goodness, I have so much respect for you and Andrew and Betty's and all these people. It was extremely difficult to be like Ruth and be perpetually calm when everything is just absolutely haywire and buttons and knobs and flashing in your face, and you're come with me, and people are singing from their heart, and you've got to be like technically aware. I really appreciate you 100 times as much now I've tried.
Well, Jay Seema has done most of the, he's doing all the tech work here.
Rainy, you did a beautiful job, Rainy.
Yes, I don't have to do anything.
We planned and practiced.
It wasn't off the top. We planned and I obsessed and we practiced because it turned out to be so many people. It was enough arti singers from now to the next incarnation.
And you were very calm there.
Oh, thank you. I didn't feel it, but I was trying.
You really had a handle on it and very centered. And I want to tell you that.
Thank you. It was great that I sort of knew everybody all over the world a bit. I thought that was an advantage. So I did compliment myself on being a sticky beacon, remembering everybody, you know.
Now, Terry had a question. Yeah.
No, actually, it's me, Diane.
Oh, yeah.
It's okay. You were talking about the quote about faith, that faith is really just not it's faith until experience proves it's right. So then... Hmm. Then what is faith is usually meaning spiritual or religious, right?
But that was intuition, wasn't it, Jeff?
Yeah, I mean, the quote I gave is faith is an intuition yet to be experienced through, yet to be proven through experience. But intuition, that's all. You can call it spiritual, you can call it religious, you can call it whatever, but it's still just intuition, which is invaluable. Baba said intuition is always 100% correct. So if you have an intuition that Baba is God, that is excellent. If it becomes conviction, you know, Adi, Baba's secretary, used to say, conviction in darkness, meaning conviction of Baba's avatarhood down here on earth. Conviction in darkness is God realization in disguise.
Wow.
It's your God realization has been implanted in you. It's just a matter of time before the time bomb goes off. And everything else disappears. Anyone have anything? Oh, go ahead.
There was another one about the faith also, Jeff. Remember that faith is believing in, what was that? What you don't see, and the result of faith is to see what you believe in. Something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, what's... I know the quote. It's an excellent quote, but I can't remember. Can't remember.
The beginning goes like faith is believing in what you don't see, and the result of faith is to see what you believed in. The gist is that.
Yeah, yeah.
Can you put that in the chat? That was really good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jeff?
Yes.
I just was reading something regarding faith.
Good.
Can I read it?
Yes.
You must have complete faith in me. when an individual has 100% faith in me and leaves everything to me, the burden automatically falls on my shoulders. I have my universal work to do, and I am totally engrossed in it. But the weight of that individual's burden reminds me of my responsibility toward him, and I do everything for such a person.
Beautiful.
This is a You and I book, Rick Chapman.
Yeah. No, it's Baba, by putting our faith in him and putting everything on him is actually, I think, lightens his burden. But I thought I'd tell the story of, maybe some of you have heard of it, called, it was a story that Baba told the men Mandali, and Erich would share it from time to time. But this is Baba. It's the jeweler and the con man. I think some of you know this story, but and this comes directly from Baba. There was this jeweler who, a diamond merchant, who was very respectable and famous. And he sold his diamonds to, you know, the wealthy people, not only just in his own country, in his own city, but other cities and in the world. But he was very clever because he didn't travel by camel or caravan, because the robbers would know that's where there's got to be something worthwhile, something valuable in these caravans. And so he would go on foot from place to place, and just like an ordinary man. But there was a con man who was very smart about things. He kind of knew his way around town, and he spotted this guy, and he knew this is the diamond merchant. And he followed his movements around, and he discovered that he was going to go to a particular city. So the con man stood outside the city gates, and when the merchant came out, you know, kind of very casually said, "Well, where are you going, sir?" And he says, "Well, I'm going to such and such a town." "Oh, I'm going there too, you know, why don't you come along with me?" So the merchant says, "Sure, that'll be nice. There'll be two of us, we can keep each other company." So they start walking, and they're walking on, and they come to the first city. The merchant goes, does some of his business in the city, and of course, the con man is doing his profession out in the city, conning people. But when they get to bed at night, that first night, they lay down, and of course the con man doesn't go to sleep, he stays awake. And when the merchant, this is Baba telling the story, when the merchant starts snoring, then the con man, he's in the dark though, he starts fumbling through all of his belongings, you know, looking for his packet of gems and diamonds. So he goes through, and he spends hours and hours without any success. You know, he doesn't really get any sleep. And the next day they go on to another city. They go on walking again. And the merchant thinks he's just a friendly guy, and he's playing just a role of an ordinary person. They go to the next place. They do their business at the city, and then they go to an inn and they stay the night. So the next night he's in there, he's going through all of his clothes. He's even going through the lining of his clothes in the dark, trying to find these diamonds and everything. Spends a whole night, he doesn't find anything. You know, he's not getting much sleep. And they go to the next city, and he gets so daring that he starts, you know, to kind of go on his bedroll. And when the guy turns over, he kind of goes around behind him and seeing if he can find any sign of these gems. And eventually, you know, later on, he starts going under his pillow while he's lying there sleeping. It goes on and on. Eventually, weeks go by, and they finally get to the destination. The merchant has gone and delivered his gems and everything. And as he's coming out to leave the city, the con man comes up to him and says, "Sir, you know, I'm a con man. And I've been following you because I knew you were a wealthy merchant. And, you know, I was trying to find out where you had hidden your packet of gems and diamonds. And every night, I've hardly had any sleep looking for these things. If you tell me where you had hidden those diamonds, your packet of gems, I will become your disciple." And the, you know, the merchant is, "I didn't realize you were doing that. But really, tell me, where, I have to know, where did you hide the diamonds?" And he said, "Well, I thought if you weren't honest and everything, I would hide them. And what I did is I hid them in your satchel. You know, and I thought if you would never seem, if you were dishonest, you would never think to look there." And so then Baba ends by saying that, you know, people look for God everywhere outside of themselves. And, you know, God is within.
That's beautiful.
And there's a line from Rumi where he says, "With a basket of freshly baked bread on your head, you go from door to door begging for a few dry crusts." Great image. With a basket of freshly baked bread on your head, you go from door to door begging for a few dry crusts. So anyway, I remember Eric telling that story.
That's great.
Oh, Jeff, could you tell the story of your God is under your feet, the gold story?
Okay. Oh. Okay. Here's the line from that very, it's a famous line from that very must-like person, that saint kind of must. But he wrote this line, if I can remember it. "In the battle of love, none but the lovers are slain. The weak and wicked escape from injury. O you who are the true lover, flee not from the battle. Those who are not killed are dead to love." That's Sarman. That's his. "In a battle of love, none but the lovers are slain. The weak and wicked escape from injury. O you who are the true lover, flee not from the battle. Those who are not killed are dead to love." So you want me to tell that story? Well, first, let's see if there's anybody had anything. That might be pressing or something they're pondering or deliberating on.
I just wanted to say, with the story you just shared about the jeweler and the con man, how I'd never heard the very ending where Baba talks about and relates that story to us in the sense of carrying the basket of bread, fresh baked bread on our head, and then going around begging for dry crust. I love that. It's a wonderful perspective, and how great of a reminder that is in terms of, you know, seeking worldly things. You know, we have Baba right here with us, and yet we go around seeking worldly pleasures in all kinds of forms that will never mount to the, you know, to Baba next to us. I just love that perspective. Very visual, very clear. The divine game and how it kind of plays out.
Yeah. The one thing that complicates it is we also have to find Baba in others, not just ourselves. That complicates the thing infinitely. I think of the masculine is Baba in me, and the feminine is Baba in each other. Both of those. I once asked I once asked Esfandiar, who was like, if I were to put a bet on someone being a saint, it would have been Esfandiar, if you're ever with him. But I asked him, are you able to see Baba in others? And Farshid, you know, he said something, and then Farshid translated it as, I have not yet attained to that high state. Now, here's Erich. Now, when you would go to Marizad, Erich would, you know, embrace you and say, Jay Baba Michael, Jay Baba Meth. You know, he'd hug you and everything like that. But on Baba's birthday, at 5 a.m, in Baba's bedroom, when they would gather there, Erich would go around and he would hug somebody and say, look at them and say, I love you, Baba. And he would hug this one. I love you, Baba. You know, so he went around, he was seeing everyone as, you might say, Baba in disguise, his beloved. That's incredible what he was able to do. And I'm sure many of you had the experience when you met Erich. I felt that he was relating to me as I had always known myself. And he was just meeting me for the first time, because he got the essence of me, the God in me. Yeah. And that is something that we carry all the way from childhood up to the present moment. Yeah. Anyway, I think though, well, before I answer that, Rainey, let's see if Josh, you got any other thing.
Yes, so I have a question for people to answer in their own ways. The question is, how do you get sort of the feeling of Baba or the atmosphere of being around Baba into your daily life?
Great question.
I find it's different every day. Like, I can't have a formula to it. If I try sometimes, it's like it's different every day. But one thing I've been doing over the last year is instead of praying, because I used to say the prayer, but I would say it mindlessly. And in the last year, I kind of journal, or I write, I just like pretend I'm writing to Baba, or just write what's on my mind, whatever I'm struggling with or whatever. And it's maybe I'm kind of repeating things here and there, but it has to be different every day. I never go back and read them either. It's like each day it's something different.
Yeah, where you're getting, you're writing and you kind of feel Baba is there receiving it.
Yeah, or he's doing it. Like, I don't even know. And my mom asks me, how do you write all these like amazing things? Like, how do you do it so quickly or in the morning or whatever? I'm like, I'm not doing it. I don't know. If I try to do it, or I think about, okay, what should I write today? It doesn't happen. But if I just kind of do it, it's from your heart, then it's like he's writing it. Yeah.
Yeah. Beautiful. Anyone else? That's a very good question, Jess. Anyone else kind of give an idea of how they awaken Baba's? Yeah, Diane.
I had to really do behavior mod. So I set a timer at 12 o'clock and at 5 o'clock every day that says, say Baba's name. Now, I think about him now a lot more often than 12 or 5, but that started me off. And then I was told to, he should be the first thought when you wake up. Well, usually that's not the case. But then I remind myself that I can react differently to what I could have done, and remind myself I can talk about Baba, and I now say, Baba, take over.
Beautiful.
And that kind of helps me. And whenever I have to make a phone call, like, you know, a negotiation or anything that's challenging or at all, whether it be business or personal, I ask Baba's help. So it's been my mind telling myself, about this, and it's starting to actually have a mind of its own, if you will.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah.
Josh, when I was very young and a singer your age, I used to suffer from, it's scandalous that advertise about, I used to suffer from uncontrollable nervousness where my entire body would shake. I mean, to the point I would stop halfway through a song and just burst into tears and have to leave the stage at Avatar's Abode or whatever. And so I sort of thought about it. And one day I was looking at my songbook and thought it'd be really good if I had a clear gel of Barbara's face to put over each song. And always, even if I know the song by heart, put that on the floor with the words, with the clear gel of Barbara's face, which was rather hard to do back in the olden days. But I got hold of one.
And I used to. What do you mean by clear gel?
A clear lamla that you can see through, but it has an image of Barbara's face on it.
Yeah.
And a man with a photography shop made me one. And so I used to put it over the song. And somehow I got so used to that, it took away my nerves, which were chronic. I mean, they were on the level with people that bang their head on the wall to sing opera and stuff that are nervous. It was chronic. I would shake uncontrollably. And because I was around all these mighty singers and poets and composers. Anyway, this clear gel, eventually I didn't need the gel. Eventually the clear gel with Barbara's face, and he wasn't young in this picture. He was sort of, you know, 50-something-ish. And eventually that clear gel, I could see it whenever I was nervous, it would just come up. And I would see and talk to people, even at work, it was still there. It just slowly became there. It was visual at the start. It was external, you know. And eventually I didn't need the piece of plastic. And eventually when I sing, even if I'm looking at myself, that gel, psychologically anyway, is there. And sometimes, as you know, things are so extreme that you do need a physical medium in between to keep focused. Anyway, I found something like that helpful because eventually, of course, it became in my heart and it wasn't like that. But when I was very young, I was such a chronic condition, I needed a tool.
Yeah, beautiful. I know Baba comes up, and we'll get Michael now, but Baba comes up with such beautiful ways that help us tailor-made to our particular, complex or whatever. Michael, what?
Well, I found that if I could handle upsets, because, you know, when you have an upset, usually somebody else is to blame in your mind. And you think about them and what you're going to say to them, et cetera, rather than Baba. So I had started just dropping things as soon as I could so that I didn't want to waste time with these upsets and these people, because I enjoyed being in a state of love. And it was before Darshan, and I was driving around the South working for New Line Cinema, and I stopped at a campground to save money rather than go to a motel. And I stopped by the stream, and I was just overcome with this emotion. So the lyrics that I wrote to the song was, listen to the bubbling stream beside you, watch the droplets dancing in the sunlight. They're flowing ever onward until they reach the sea, and there with salty tears, they will be won. I listen to can't remember all the words. Listen to the leaves thrashing in the wind. But there was this feeling of flowing and this ecstasy in the wind and the sound that supersedes all these other thoughts. So seeing Baba everywhere, a lot of times I get curious. I think he knows everything. Everything, how could he know everything about everybody all the time? And I think about these enormous questions that can't be answered until, of course, your God realized. And I found myself thinking about him all the time. I look out at a little dog and the way she is, and I'm thinking, how did she come up with all those hairs, individual white hairs on that black? What did she do, plan this before she was born? And the contemplation of the eternal that I find myself thinking of of Meher Baba, and of course, having a loving relationship. Every time I get kissed or hugged, I think that's what Baba's doing. And when I found out that I had found out about him the day after he died, one of the thoughts that went through my mind was that I'd never have his embrace. But that's not true. I have it every night. So there's a lot to be grateful for. And in that gratitude, there is this thought of him. It may not be the face, because if God is everywhere, that's him in a grander scale than just focusing on a photograph and on the external and going inside and trying to find him wherever I could, wherever I can. So
you're pretty good at that too, Michael. And your poetry bears that out, you know.
Did you know that I'm committed to forming or recruiting an army of 100,000 warrior poets? I never told you that, did I?
Well, you hinted at something like that.
I am committed to the transformation of mankind. And what is needed is people speaking from their hearts, their own words, their own perception of God, and whatever, but just truly from their hearts. Baba said people would respond to that in the nature of love. And I believe that that's our job, our work, Baba work, to express love to others, no matter how difficult or embarrassing that is, or dangerous, because it might get dangerous at points. So,
you know, that the other night when you read poetry, and I forget the person's name that read poetry, I mean, I was really touched by that. And I've only written one poem in my life, and I have it somewhere around me, but I can't find it. I've looked for it. But it was, I didn't write the poem. I mean, I think real poetry comes through the truth of who you are. But one night, and it sort of answers what you were saying, like I came home from a meeting and it was dark out, it was very late out. And I went on my porch and suddenly time stopped. I don't know if I can even say, when I go into love, I just go into tears. But I came on the porch and it was like time stopped. And suddenly it was like I became everything in the night. I became the hooting owl. I became the ant. I became the blade of grass. I became everything. I was everything. And it was like everything was love. But it was a language, and I was that language of love, of everything that was God, that it was only. It was only God. But and I mean, we always think of human, but I mean, animals, that's what brought me to Baba to begin with, was his love for animals, because I couldn't stand what the Bible said, that they should only be there for our pleasure. And animals were so beautiful. So animals have always, birds, and I mean, they really speak to me. But what that leads to is there's nothing that's not God, but that's what the answer. And the God is love and everything.
Well, let me encourage you to keep on speaking up, because that's poetry, what I hear now.
Yeah.
So, and that's what people, you know, all the violence on TV and the commercials, it's designed to cut people off from whom they are. And in that desperation to be or feel something, they buy something, or they smoke, or they're addicted. But to hear words like that, based upon just what you see, without spending one nickel. it's wonderful. You've been hiding, Marie.
No,
that's one poem. That's one poem. I can put in words. I wrote it. I love it, because it was like a living love song from God.
No, she has many beautiful experiences. You do, Marie. Yeah. What about Ganesh? I mean, he just pulled in here from Pune. Anything or?
Yes. No, I'm just listening. I'm happy to be here listening. So
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. I was hoping Alan had a very, maybe he'll share on Tuesday, but he had a wonderful, another very touching experience with Baba. And, but I guess probably he saw a little too much Zoom today. because I did see him on a few of them myself. But I want to mention too that Marwan Mistry, who is, you know, grew up in and met Baba, and his family is all connected with Baba. He's going to talk not this Tuesday, possibly the next Tuesday. I'll let you know. And he, you know, he wanted to be interviewed, but he had some great times with Baba, and his uncle was, or maybe his great uncle was Dada Chanji, Baba's first secretary. So his mother's side of the family are all the Dada Chanjis, but he's got some great, great stories to tell, especially Baba in Guru Prasad playing Larisk, playing card games. And he was a young kid, but he kind of did some very funny things. You'll like it. Josh, did we answer any, a little bit of your, how to get Baba's presence, what to do to encourage that?
I often find by going to Baba meetings, and even this, you know, I come here and I get it, and it it's crazy, you know, it recharges me, you know, on like some kind of visceral level. I feel completely different after coming to a Baba Zoom or a Baba meeting.
Yeah.
And, but I also do what Anita does, where I've journaled to Baba for a long time, and I've got lots of books filled with just writing to Baba, which I feel is really good, but I'm always on the hunt. So it's really great to hear what these people are saying. And I loved Rainey's having that picture of Baba, and I love the poetry. That's all, I'm always looking to hear more ways of how people cultivate Baba's presence in their life. So please open up. Don't be shy.
Yeah. Hey, well, I want to ask Mayor Prasad, tell him how you begin and end your day, because I mean, you probably have heard this, but it's a valuable thing to do. The bookends of your day, you might say.
Yeah. And Baba, in one of his messages, tells that before you wake up, you say these words. Where you go, Baba, I now begin to entrust all my thoughts, words, and deeds to you. You say that for 5 minutes. Sometimes your thoughts may go here and there, but if you do it with all your heart, and throughout the day, you, before beginning anything, you say, Baba, it is you, not I, who is doing so and so. So if you're, let's say you're going into a meeting, you say, Baba, it is you, not I, who is participating in this. And then after the meeting is over, you say, Baba, it is you, not I, who participated in that meeting. So you do it to you know, as many activities as possible. And then at the end of the day, you say, Baba, I entrust all that I did, thought, or spoke, good or bad, to you. And you say that for 5 minutes again. So, you know, throughout the day, if you do that, Baba guides you in how to, you know, how you can bring him more into your life. But I noticed one thing is, initially, I was craving for the presence of Baba's presence. With me, but over time, you know, as I realized that that's not really what he wants. He wants us to remember him irrespective of whether we feel his presence or not. Sometimes it's just not, you don't feel like remembering him, and you know, but he guides you in in remembering him, even when you don't feel that. You know, Mani was saying, and this I heard this many times, but this morning it really struck me, that when Baba dropped his body, you know, they didn't feel like doing anything. And Iruch, until Iruch told her, we should continue to do what pleases him, no matter how we feel. It doesn't matter how we feel his presence, but we should continue to do what pleases him. And that kind of, that still applies to all of us, because, or at least for me, because it doesn't matter how we are feeling about his presence, but remembering him is what really matters. And over time, he also makes you realize how little you remember him throughout the day. And, you know, that kind of causes you to remember him more and more from your heart, because he makes you realize both of those, how little you remember him throughout the day and how shallow your remembrance is. So you try to do that more. That's been my experience.
Beautiful.
Can I add on to that, Jeff, something that's familiar to Joshua? I can only get away, you know, 3 weeks of the year. 2 weeks I go to Australia and Avatar's abode and to my friends and family in Australia. And 1 week I give to Asheville, which I have been adding Myrtle Beach onto. But anyway, 1 year things had been so intense with my daughter's near death spine problem and whatever. I finally got back home and she'd had her surgery. She could walk again and everything. And I got to Avatar's abode and I always go straight into Baba's room. As soon as I get my rental car off the plane, all in one go, I do it. I go into his room and I just got there and suddenly realized, oh, I'm here. Oh, gosh, I did it. It's a day and a half later and I'm actually here. So what am I supposed to do? This is in about 2016. What am I supposed, will I just sing the arti? You know, and I was so wound up because I made it and we got through it. And I obviously had chronic PTSD, but I didn't know that at the time. Anyway, I just sat there and I couldn't think of anything to do. And even the Australian arti wouldn't come back into my head. And all of a sudden my Baba voice said, when you're this close to me, it's not what you do, it's what I do to you.
Beautiful. Yeah, say that again. That's wonderful.
When you're here and this close to me, it's not what you do, it's what I do to you. I'm the one doing here. And then I just sat down and I might have even fallen asleep. I can't remember. I was just a puddle at that point. I just, oh, wow, I don't have to do anything. I didn't know how not to do anything. And he took it all off me. So even when we don't know, he's doing. As he says in that song, he's doing it. He's loving us all the time. He's there all the time. And we just sort of tap in like a water spout, you know, when you remember him so many times a day and whatever, but that's continuous. It's what he does to us and how he's being over us and how he's coming through us. I think that's a nice thing to remember too. He's coming through us. And so one thing I've learned is, and I learned it actually through a singing technique, and that is to brighten one's eyes. It's not like this. It's like if you see a stranger coming towards you and you think, do I know this person? You brightening the eyes has a skill to set some sort of relaxation through the brain to the heart and so on. Singers do it all the time to relax the throat and relax, you brighten your eyes. Somehow when you brighten your eyes, you relax more. And you know that famous thing that all every child wants when they come running into the room is for their parents to beam at them. It's all they want. Then they'll run right back out of the room again because they brighten their eyes and you're gorgeous. That's how Baba sees us all the time. We're gorgeous and he's with us all the time.
Boy, beautiful, Rainey. Yeah, I feel that. He loves and adores us no matter what. And all the religious stuff can go out the window. and he loves us no matter what. I mean, even
no matter what.
Yeah.
He loves you more than you can ever love yourself. He is kinder to you than you are to yourself. Constantly watchful while you neglect yourself. He guards and guides you on the short path to yourself. J may her J. J may her J. J may her J. J J J J J J may her.
Is that Francis?
Yes, it's from section ABCD F of A Singing to the Eternal Beloved.
Do that once again. Can you remember it?
J may her J. J may her J. J may her J. J J A J A J A J A may her. He who is compassion. Oh no, I'm going to the wrong section. It's got four sections to it. But he loves you more than he loves you more than you can ever love yourself. He is kinder to you than you are to yourself. Constantly watchful while you neglect yourself. He guards and guides you on the short path to yourself. J may her J. J may her J. J may her J. J J A J A J A J A may her.
Beautiful.
Francis sang this to Baba and wrote it for him for his last birthday in February 1968. And Baba, he knew he had to write something special. He didn't know how he knew. And so he wrote an entire medley, A through G of songs. And it goes for about half an hour. It's on a little CD called A Singing to the Eternal Beloved. But that's a really inspiring song, lyrics in it.
You know, one thing that Baba said to Arnavas, referring to some of the things you said, Josh, Baba said, I didn't ask you to feel me, I asked you to love me. You can love Baba without feeling him. I mean, because love is on a different, love is different from feelings. I mean, love can express itself through feelings, but love is on a different track. And one of the things that I've always found is I used to, in the early on, there's another whole story with Mara on this, but I'll bring it up sometime. But, you know, I used to put a lot of importance into feeling Baba. And I would have the feeling of Baba and I feel that joy in my heart. And then a couple hours later, it'd be gone. I'm thinking, what did I do? Oh my God, I lost it. But Amara, through various things, convinced me. It's enough just to know that Baba is there, even if you don't feel that he's there. That knowing is a gift. If you know that Baba is with you, even if you, it's always nice to feel him, but that knowing is constant. You know, it is a gift. You can be, you know, in a ditch, hungry and cold, but you can know that Baba loves you, even if you're not feeling it. It's something great. Hey, but Alan, you do you feel like sharing that at all, or save it for a Tuesday or another night?
Oh, sharing which part?
That what you shared, I think it was last night or night before last.
About the thing I read in Discourses. Is that what you're, yeah, is that what you're referring to?
Well, the experience you had with Baba there.
Oh yeah, I don't have the exact book or the quote on me right now. I could maybe share it in a little bit when I grab the book. But I did want to share that I thought it was really helpful to hear God, his name just slipped from my mind. What's the man with a large white beard or mustache, that Rick Chapman?
Yeah.
Yeah, when I asked him that question about you know, his life, the difference between his life before he met Baba, when he met Baba, and now that he's in his life every day without the physical form, and he basically turned the mirror and was like, you know, basically what Padre said to a lot of people on video, which was like, is God not here right now? Like, are you not with Baba right now? And I was just like, it kind of really helped me to reflect on the physical form. And because I guess it's in my mind, you know, you mentioned this, Jeff, about Baba's physical form being, you know, holding on to his Dhamma is really a form of like that doorway to the infinite aspect of God. And there is a part of me that really, really wants to be in his physical presence again, you know, like really, really wants to be there with him physically on in a body with my eyes, with my senses with him. And yet what Rick was kind of reflecting to me was like, he's just as much right here, right now with you asking me this question and all of us here present now as he will ever be. He's right here. And you don't have to go running in the woods or anywhere else to find him. And I just really appreciated that reflection. And it was a stark reminder. It was like just the way that he was speaking about it, there was a certain level of conviction or something, somewhere he was standing or somewhere he was there with himself that helped to reflect that to me. So yeah, that was just very, very helpful and beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah. The beautiful thing, even though Baba is not physically here, although he can even be physically here, it's possible, but that his personality is always here. That's the amazing thing. I mean, Baba's still doing things that have his particular signature on them. You know, it's not like he, you know, that's a beautiful thing. I mean, someone could have a relationship with Jesus even now. Jesus is right here. If you kind of get away from believing in him and kind of enjoy his companionship, a Christian could have Jesus's companionship and a lot of the humor that Jesus had that's kind of gotten lost historically. They'd have a relationship the way we have with Baba. Is that personality is always there. Yeah, Peter.
Yeah, hi Jeff. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
Going through? Okay. I was hoping so. I guess I'm responding to Joshua. He says, open up, open up. And I'm here and I'm pretty quiet and I'm freaking out over my living situation. The thing is though, when people are talking about remembering him, I'm trying to think of where to even begin. Because sometimes I think I went through a little bit of a unique way. And I remember, you know, a long time ago when I had the choice of going with Baba, I did out of necessity, like a lot of people do. And I remember I wanted to be very, very financially successful. You know, one thing happened and I listened to a program about how to be successful. And a man said one technique or one way is to listen to audios of people who you admire and respect. And of course I wanted to be wealthy, but then I said, who do I know that I want to emulate? Who do I know that I wanted to admire and respect? And I thought of nothing further. Well, where I started was mondleyhall.org. I remember on Mondley Hall, there is a plethora of audios, and I went through from the top and, you know, listen to Mara, Mani, Arnavas was one of my favorites. I don't know, something to do with Arnavas I love. And I remember when I looked at Erich, that man had so many audios on that book. I said, well, I want to be thorough. I want to listen to all of them. I said, how in the hell am I going to go through all those? And I said, let me just start. and put it out of my mind and just keep on hammering down. And the interesting thing was, I was unemployed at the time, and I'd go to the park, and I learned how to use an MP3 player. I downloaded talk after talk after talk of Erich, and I remember rewinding, listening, because I kept on misunderstanding what he was saying. And I think that way of remembrance has drilled it into me. And also, because I had such a contentious, fearful knowing of Mayor Baba, there's a guy that came to India, that came to the Tampa Bay group. And I remember him saying something like, knowing Baba is just like that of any relationship. Like you have to know someone to trust somebody. And I know I really didn't trust him. I didn't trust Baba. And I thought, how could I learn to trust the man? And I thought of no other better way than to read Lord Mayhair, because that's his biography. So I started reading Lord Mayhair. And you know, the interesting thing is that I don't think I was ready for knowing him as a person. And I remember going to the Tampa Bay group, and some people were talking about reading as a way of remembrance, listening to Mongoli as a way of remembrance. And that's all good. It's like, I think, provisional ego. So that's, I think sometimes I went in an unconventional way, because I get really jealous of how people love the hell out of them. And I'm just not there in many ways. I'm just not there, but I do what I do. And you know, I think there's so many different ways I remember him. Though I think what I enjoyed and I really felt relieved about Erich is his practicality. Although I can listen to the highfalutin spiritual topics and talks in Lord Mayhair, I like just the practicalness of Erich, making him a companion. I don't say constant, it's not constant. But to me, when I was afraid of my own shadow, one thing that has brought me relief from anxiety is knowing that anytime I feel lost or lonely or fearful, sometimes I don't think it's a matter of me even needing to remember him, but he reminds me right there, he's right there. And although it could be contentious, I could still have a conversation or look for his input right then and there. And the thing is, although to me it was more detached before and he was more of a domineering present, it's slowly becoming much more endearing and ensuring. And although I have a lot of anxiety, I think his presence is becoming much more endearing than it ever has been before.
Right, beautiful.
And, you know, one thing I'll throw in too is sometimes it's shocking how much, I'm trying to think of how to say it, how many points of contact we have. It blows my mind that we have Lord Mayhair, that's 20 volumes. It blows my mind that thing is 20 volumes long, 20 damn volumes, and having places like mondleyhall.org where we have all the recordings in Zoom. So it's not that I absolutely enjoy it, but to me, I consider it like spiritual food. It's there to eat and devour. Sometimes I enjoy the hell out. Well, sometimes it's a joy, and sometimes it's just done as a practice, but it's there, which I like.
Lord Mayhair is considered the third longest biography in history.
And dare I ask, what are the first two?
What's that?
What are the first two, do you know?
I don't know. I think maybe something on Churchill. I think there's something, but Bob is up there, you know. 20 volumes, one biography.
Let Churchill get in there as being number one or number two.
I don't know. Just, you know, maybe scholars. I think it might be Churchill. Just he's someone wanted to write about crazily. Well, let's see. Do you think it might be a good time to everybody to take a break from a day of Zoom? I don't know. I kind of think so. I think tomorrow night there are some wonderful, important things well worth seeing. And you have to get a break from Zoom for a little bit. That's my thought.
Hey, Jeff, what's happening tomorrow night?
Wow. There's a Heartland Center.
Oh, that's right. The program. Yeah,
Charles Haynes is going to talk. There's a 7-minute movie of Mara. I mean, it might be longer, of Mara that they've rediscovered, of talking about the accident. That is very touching. And I would think it was filmed early on, too. Not, you know, not so much later in their life, but maybe in the 70s. Let's see. I got Rainey, that what you said, this reminds me. I've got I'll read a poem and then we'll have a last quote. Maybe let me just check here. You know, that we were talking about, he loves us, loves and adores us no matter what. That this is on this theme a little bit. This captures a bit of my view of Baba. It's a rendering of Dan Ladinsky of Hafiz. But I said to Danny one time, we used to be roommates a long time ago, I said, you're putting Erich into poetry. And he said, and he confessed, yeah, that's what he's doing. So this poem is called Perfect Equanimity. Look how a mirror will reflect with perfect equanimity all actions before it. There is no act in this world that will ever cause the mirror to look away. There is no act in this world that will ever make the mirror say no. The mirror, like perfect love, will just keep giving of itself to all before it. How did the mirror ever get like that, so polite, so grand, so compassionate? It watched God. Yes, the mirror remembers the beloved looking into itself as the beloved shaped existence's heart and the mirror's soul. My eye has the nature of God. Hafiz looks upon all with perfect equanimity. My poems will never tell you no, because the mirror is not like that. And if God ever hits you with a don't, he has his fingers crossed. He's just fibbing for your own good. And if God ever hits you with a don't, he has his fingers crossed. He's just fibbing you for your own good. I think that captures, that kind of agrees with my view of Baba. You know, you feel like, oh, you could do something and cause Baba to turn away, but there's nothing. I mean, we don't want to do terrible things, but even if we did something terrible, he will never turn his glance away. Well, we'll have either Ganesh or maybe Mayor Prasad can come up with one last quote of Baba's.
Jeff, just to make it really funny, I made sure I keyed that incorrectly, the little chorus in section C or something, but suddenly I remembered, isn't there a funny part to this that Baba liked, section F2? And sure enough, there is a really funny part. I'll read one verse because it's hilarious.
Yeah.
Because it relates to the mirror.
And this was read to Baba by, or sung to Baba by?
The whole songbook was sung to Baba by Francis on Baba's last birthday, 1968, February 25th.
Beautiful, yeah.
It's on this little CD, A Singing to Your Eternal Beloved. The Mandalay asked us to do it, and we formed a little group, the First Love Street Singers at Maribad, and we did it for them again because they hadn't heard it since Baba was alive. Anyway, this last one, section F1, says, it's got the corniest tune, but anyway, I'm sorry, young ones. I'll just recite it. Though you've tried oh so hard to love you, knowing there's none worthier of love than you, something in you still remains dissatisfied in spite of all the years you have tried. For Mahababa loves you more than you can ever hope to love your own dear loving self, for he's whole God and perfect man. He's the very self of yourself.
So read that once again. I was trying to, at the beginning, I was trying to think of who is you and who is...
yourself in the mirror. You're trying to love yourself. You've tried very hard to love yourself. Though you've tried oh so hard to love you, knowing there's none worthier of love than you, something in you remains dissatisfied in spite of all the years you have tried. For Mahababa loves you more than you can ever hope to love your own dear loving self. For he is whole God and perfect man. He is the very self of yourself.
Beautiful.
So fun, huh? I like that in one he says, though you've tried oh so much to love you in a way that would be really right for you, this is the second verse, something in you still remains unsupplied in spite of all the years you have tried. Oh yes, he's got that rhyme there, Michael, of dissatisfied, unsupplied and denied when you try to love ourselves.
Great.
Yeah, it's very fun. It's a very fun thing.
Yeah, beautiful. Okay, well, let's see. Have we got a... Ganesh, did you find anything there, or Mayor Prasad?
Yeah.
Or anybody else?
All right. Nobody else is going to read. I can read a quote.
Good.
Those who are united in love know no separation. Wherever I am, wherever you are, I am always with you. That's it.
Yeah, read it once again.
Those who are united in love know no separation. Wherever I am, wherever you are, I am always with you.
I've got a similar one like that. Wherever you are, I'm always with you. I'm the only friend who will never let you down.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's have a few moments of silence.
Jay Baba.
You're on mute, Jeff.
Sorry, you were muted, Jeff.
I looked up and everybody was still had their eyes closed, and I had said Jay Baba.
I saw you go Jay Baba, so I just wanted to let everybody know you had.
I'm hoping to get a Goer Mobed to continue the second part of her sharing of her father's life, Minu Karas, who was one of the Mandali, and then her own meetings with Baba. Now, I'm hoping that next Sunday. And then I think maybe the following Tuesday can be Marwan Mystery to let you know. And maybe we could get one more poem out of Michael Childs. One of the PG versions.
I made that CD of Rhoda Mystery. Jeff, I'll have something ready and the story of how she had me make that CD of her.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, Rhoda Mystery.
Well, this is my mystical poem. You can tell by the name, Ghazal Y. Reaching deeper into the silence that men fear as death, there is a silver ring that glistens in the light. Held in my palm, it glows with its own heat. Inside, a small inscription reads, "Fear not, love well." Placing it on my finger, I fall backwards in a swoon, falling, ever falling, nightmares chase my eyelids. Falling, still yet falling, sweet music fills my soul. Falling, further falling, a wondrous light surrounds me. Falling, falling, falling into a brilliance greater than a million suns, all shapes and forms within it, latent with creation. Still falling, I learn that love is both walking and falling, never holding, trying to restrain the falling into the nothingness of life, which others fear as death. Falling requires trust. Trust requires courage. Find your ring and wear it, even if it burns. Jay Baba.
Jay Baba, thank you. Wow. Okay, well, let's see. I guess, let me see. Marinaz, are you still up this late hour? Shams, we didn't, Shams never quite appeared, but.
Jay Baba, Jeff, yes, of course I am up.
Oh.
This is only 9 o'clock our time.
Oh, where are you? I can't see you.
That's right, I'm under the table.
Oh, okay. But
what do you expect me after a whole day, Sahavas, or 2.5 days, literally?
I know.
I mean, my eyes is like
unbelievable. I know. I just can't believe it. I mean, my pulse rate is down to about 24, you know. I'm down to the pilot light. But so we'll end.
I've done 10 steps today.
What we'll have is Nasreen has to finish this all off. Sham, great to see you. Nasreen?
Yeah. Yes, I'm here.
She's gonna ring the closing bell.
Okay, ready?
Yes.
Avatar Meher Baba Ki Jai. Avatar Meher Baba Ki Jai. Avatar Meher Baba Ki Jai.
That's it. Now I can go to bed.
Thank you, Jeff. I give everyone
permission to just fall into bed fully dressed, okay? Yeah. Just fall in, kick your shoes off if you happen to wake up. Just fall in fully dressed.
Yeah.
That's exactly where we are.
Sleep in your clothes. Tonight, tonight you can sleep in your clothes.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank yeah. you.
So
thank
just
you,
Jeff. Remember, tomorrow night, there's if you look up under the Heartland Center, I think
you have to register.
You need to register.
Yeah. And all you do is just, real simple to register, and then you can get on. It's well worth it. Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Jay Bob, everybody.
Jay Bob, thanks for everything else. Thank you, Jeff.
Jay Bob.
Thank you all. Jay Bob.
Jay Bob.